Matthew chapter 9 and verse 27, when Jesus departed thence, two blind men followed him, crying and saying, "Thou son of David, have mercy on us." And when he was come into the house, the blind men came to him. And Jesus saith unto them, "Believe ye that I am able to do this?" They said unto him, "Yea, Lord." Then touched he their eyes, saying, "According to your faith be it unto you." Now there's much that we can see here, these three verses. And yet there's much going on here. And there's time that's passed that you don't maybe catch just reading these three verses quickly as we just did. But in verse 27, Jesus departed. He's raised Jairus' daughter from the dead. And he's left there, and now he's going somewhere else. And some might say he's going to where he was going to spend the night. There is speculation. I don't know that anyone knows just where he was headed. You know, there's a time in his ministry where he stayed with Peter and Peter's mother-in-law. You remember how he lifted her up when she had a great fever and he touched her by the hand. And so he may have been going where he was going to be staying the night. We don't know where he was headed. But he's left Jairus' place and raised that little girl from the dead, and now he's headed down the street. And it says, while he's going, there's two blind men that followed him. And these two blind men, now we don't know how they followed him. Tradition sometimes tells us that there was a little boy leading them. And so we don't know. We don't have all the story here, but two blind men followed him, crying and saying, "Thou son of David, have mercy on us." And then see the next phrase, it says, when he was coming to the house. I sometimes ask people, what house? Because all we have here is he's left Jairus' house, and now he's come to another house. And so I ask people, what house? And people just say, huh? Well, who knows what house? I don't suppose anyone knows. But the inference is that he finally arrived to where he was going, and I don't think the house was across the street. I don't think it was just down the block. I don't know how far away it was, but he walked the whole way. From one house to another house, he's left Jairus' house, he's raised this little girl from the dead, and he left there, and two blind men now are following him, crying and saying, and the inference there is more than once. It doesn't say they cried and said. It says crying and saying. So they are demonstrating some determination. I think God today still responds to determination. He responds to hunger. If you hunger and thirst after righteousness, you'll be filled. If you seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, then things are added to you. God still responds to hunger and thirst. He's a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. I think some people are casual. They want to try something out. They've heard about something. Well, I'll try that, see if it works. We've had people come here. And then I've gone to other places. We used to travel full time. We still travel some, not near so much, because I want to be right here. But we've had people come here or come to me in our meetings, and they're just going to try me out. You know, I've heard about you. I'm going to see if you've got anything. And we had one person. She said to me, she said, "Brother Tony, I know you have the gift of healing." And so that demonstrates the misunderstanding right there, because she was inferring that I had something that I could just sort of operate when I wanted to, or God would choose, you know, to operate it. And it's all up to God. Virtually everywhere I go, that's what I run into. Christians are waiting on God to do it. They're wanting God to do it, praying that God would do it. They're believing he can, and they're just wanting to know when he's going to. And they're going to keep going and keep trying and keep going to meetings and keep going for prayer until God finally decides to. They're wanting God to do it. And, well, Brother Tony, you have the gift of healing. So they try me out. I'm thinking about one person. She's brought two or three people, but all of them just one time. Just one time. And just, you've got one shot. That's it. If they don't get it in one time, that's it. You give you one time. And I almost want to push it into them if I can. You try, you know, try to push it into them because you're wanting, you care about people. You want people to be healed. You want people to receive. Well, these two blind men are following Jesus. And they're crying and saying, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on us. And he didn't even turn around. How far did they follow him? How many times did they cry it out? I don't believe Jesus is deaf. I don't believe he's hard of hearing. I believe he heard it. And you let a preacher do that today and see how far it goes. Because we don't have record at all. If you look, it just seems to, rightly so, inferred he didn't even turn around. He just waited until they continued to show some perseverance. Because if I don't have the gifts of the Spirit operating, then it'll be your faith. Unless the Holy Ghost tells me. Now in John chapter 5, the Holy Ghost did tell Jesus to go minister to one. And he went to a man that was there, and Jesus knew that it had been a long time in that case, went up to him and said, will you be made whole? And the man said, I have nobody to help me when the water is troubled. I'm on my way. I try to get there, but somebody always steps in first before me. And Jesus simply said, rise, take up your bed and walk. Well, the man didn't even know that was Jesus. He wist not or knew not who he was, for Jesus had conveyed himself away, a multitude being in that place. That's a gift of the Spirit, the sovereignty of God that operates as the Spirit wills. Well, Jesus doesn't have that everywhere. I don't have that everywhere. And when it does operate in John chapter 5, it only operated for one. And in verse 19, he explained the Son can do nothing of himself. The one that I'd healed, I didn't heal on my own. It wasn't because I wanted to. Because the Son, John 5:19, the Son can do nothing of himself. Well, if Jesus is saying that of himself, and that's Jesus, certainly I should be able to say that too. I can't do it just on my own. Jesus couldn't. And he said, he that believeth on me, the works that I do shall he do. And Jesus said in John 20, as my Father sent me, even so send I you. And he said, in my name you go. So I'm going to do what he did in his name. Well, I'll do them the way he did them. As my Father sent me, even so send I you. That's John chapter 20. So when I use the name of Jesus, I'm going to do the things he did the way he did them. And he said, John 5:19, I didn't do it of myself, but what I saw the Father do. The Son can do nothing of himself, but what he sees the Father do. So in John 5, he saw the Father do that. It's a gift of the Spirit. 1 Corinthians chapter 12 talks about the gifts of the Spirit, manifestations of the Spirit. One of those is gifts of healings. And it says there they operate as the Spirit wills. All these worketh that one and the selfsame Spirit, dividing to every man severally as he wills. Not as I will or you will, but as he wills. We should pray and desire, and God responds to prayer. He responds to desire. And 1 Corinthians 12:28, God has set some in the church. And among those listed there are gifts of healings. That is, ministers who have special endowments, special endowments. And they ought to know what they have, and then they ought to operate according to the word of God and by the Spirit. And Jesus said in John 5:19, I didn't do it by myself. I saw the Father do it. And what the Father does, the Son does likewise. Well, that's what we do. The gifts of the Spirit operate, and we do them by the Spirit as Jesus did. The Father is glorified in the Son. The Son is glorified in the church. And we do the works of Jesus in Jesus' name, and the Father's glorified. Jesus said, whatever you ask in my name, I'll do it, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. Not that we're glorified, but he's glorified. So the gifts of the Spirit operate as the Spirit wills. And in Matthew 9, he didn't have that. At any moment, he would have turned around and healed those blind people. If the Spirit of God had said to, you know that. You must know that. If the Holy Ghost had said, turn around and minister to them, Jesus would have done that, wouldn't he? At any moment, he would have turned around and ministered to those blind people. But the Holy Ghost didn't speak. So what are you going to do? Well, if the Holy Ghost isn't moving upon me to minister healing to them, a gift of healing, a gift of faith, working of miracles, those three are listed in 1 Corinthians 12, the gift of special faith, working of miracles, gifts of healings. Those are three of them, the power gifts. Well, they didn't operate. Well, if they don't operate, then what am I going to do? If they're going to be healed, then it'll be their faith. You see? In fact, you don't have record where people were healed with Jesus' faith. It doesn't ever say that. Not one time does it ever say. Jesus never one time told anybody, my faith made you whole. Did he? Never, never, never. He never one time said, me and the apostles prayed this morning and that's why you got healed. Did he ever say that? Never, never, never. But he would frequently say, your faith did it. But in John 5, he didn't say that. That man didn't even know it was Jesus. So it's not his faith. It's a gift of the Spirit. When the gifts of the Spirit operate, you don't even have to believe anything. I've been there when they would operate through me. I'd have them operate every service if it's up to me. And we'd mess it up. That's why God doesn't put it in our hands. But I've seen it, the power of God come upon me, and I act on that power, and people would receive healing and say right out loud, I don't believe it. Here they are lifting their hands when they couldn't lift their hands and saying, I don't believe it. Well, it wasn't your faith then if you don't believe it. The power of God came on me, and I was able to do something for them. I'd do it every service if I could. And Jesus said in John 5, I didn't do that on my own. And then in Matthew 9, if the Holy Ghost had said, he would have turned around and ministered to them. But there's no move of the Spirit. So if they're going to be healed, it won't be my faith. It won't be the Holy Ghost moving upon me because I don't have that. So if they're going to be healed, it'll be their faith. And if they have faith, now see, he could be thinking all of these things to himself while he's walking. He knows they're behind him. Why does he know they're behind him? They're crying and saying, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on us. They're crying and saying that. So he could be thinking the whole way he's walking, you know, whole way, time he's walking. Well, if they have faith, they won't quit. If they have faith, they won't quit. Let's see what they do then. Because, if you know, this is a mighty work. This isn't a headache. This is a mighty work. This isn't a neck ache. This isn't a back spasm. This isn't an ingrown toenail or a cramp, a foot cramp, a Charlie horse. This is a mighty work. Some small things you can do with your faith. You can carry people. And we'll refer to that in a moment. He never one time said his faith did it. But small things are different. This is not a small thing. They're blind. And so if they're going to receive healing, it'll have to be their faith, not my faith. The gifts of the Spirit are not operating. The Holy Ghost didn't speak to me. So if they're going to be healed, it'll be their faith. And if they have faith, they won't quit. God responds to determination. He does. Hunger and thirst and diligence and determination. Where you just, bless God, I'm not quitting. I'm not giving up. Amen. And he responds to that. When you know it's the will of God, the devil always wants you to wonder. The devil always wants you to wonder why you don't feel better. Well, if you're healed, why this? Well, if God's word says that, then why the other thing? Well, why? The devil's always trying to get us to wander. Somebody say amen. But when you absolutely are confident of what the word of God has said, then you can just be bold about it. And I'm not quitting. I'm not giving up. Blessed be God. This is what he said. And I believe it. That settles it. And you just stay in there. Amen. And if you've believed you received, then it's going to continue to work and you just stay with it. And so they're determined. If they are going to receive their healing, it'll be because they don't quit. Let's give them the opportunity to quit. And he doesn't even turn around. You let a preacher do that today. And people watch that. Looks like he doesn't even care about those blind guys. I don't think that's right. The woman that came to Jesus, you know, the Syrophoenician woman, and said, my daughter is grievously tormented, you know, vexed with the devil, grievously tormented. And Jesus said, it's not right to take the children's bread and give it to dogs. Called her a dog. And said, it's not right to take the children's bread and give it to dogs. Did he say that? This Syrophoenician woman came to Jesus and said, my daughter is grievously vexed with the devil and I want you to come and heal her. I want you to come. And Jesus said, it's not right to take the children's bread and to give it to dogs. Well, what did she say? She said, that's true. That's true. Let's look at this. Matthew chapter 15. Look at this. We may look at Mark's account of this too. But this woman of Canaan came out of the same coast, cried unto him, saying, have mercy on me, O Lord, thou son of David. My daughter is grievously vexed with the devil. He answered her what? Not a word. Matthew 15, 23. He answered her what? Not a word. He didn't even answer her. You let a preacher do that today. It looks like he doesn't even care. But see, he does care. He does care, but he's wanting to move her to a place of perseverance. If you're going to get something from God, you'll have to be determined, and we'll have to watch you and see, you know, if you're determined. We'll give you the opportunity to prove that you're determined. How are we going to do that? Well, we won't respond immediately. Somebody say amen. Amen. And so he answered her not a word, and his disciples came and besought him, saying, send her away, for she crieth after us. He answered and said, I am not sent, but unto the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Then came she and worshipped him. That's the second attempt. You know, that's better than the first attempt. The first attempt was, have mercy on me, on me, on me, O Lord, thou son of David. My daughter is grievously vexed with the devil. The second attempt is worship. I think sometimes people need to get first things first. They're trying to get the healing before they bring some worship. Can I have an amen, somebody? How about worship? She worshiped him, saying, Lord, help me. But he answered and said, it's not meet or right, fitting, to take the children's bread and to cast it to dogs. He called her a dog. Well, in that day, that would have been the colloquial regard, because she's an outcast. She's a Canaanite. She's a Syrophoenician woman. And she could have left right then and gone back home. I want you to see this. She could have left and gone back home. She didn't do it, but she could have. Couldn't she have? At that very moment, could she have just gone home? And she could have gone home and told all her family and told all of her friends and told all of her neighbors, I went to Jesus and I asked him to heal my daughter. You know what he said? First of all, he called me a dog. And second thing, he said it wasn't right to do that. And she would have been telling the truth. But people would miss the point, because Jesus did all of that to move her to another level, to demonstrate determination. First of all, she's not Abraham's seed. It's not like Luke 13, ought not this woman being a daughter of Abraham. She's not a daughter of Abraham. She's a Syrophoenician. She's a Canaanite woman. And so she's not one of the covenant. But if you'll move into faith, you can still get it. And what you're doing right now is not faith. You're just begging and pleading and hoping and praying. But faith will be determined. He's trying to move her to another level. And she could have missed the point. How many people today miss the point? They miss the point. They'll go home and say, well, I went there and they didn't treat me exactly the way I wish they had of. And they told me it wasn't right. Jesus called me a dog and told me it wasn't right to heal my daughter. And every word of that would have been true. Is that right? But missing the point. How many people today miss the point? And the blessing, you miss the point, you miss the blessing. But if you persevere, he's trying to move her into determined faith. He's trying to move her into determined faith. And he did. He did. He moved her into determined faith, because she could have gone away and missed the point, missed the blessing. Now you're in Matthew 15. Look at Mark 7. I like Mark's account of this. It's good to read Matthew and Mark, both of them. So he called her a dog and said, let's take the children's bread, verse 27, and give it to the children first. Let the children first be filled. It's not meet or fitting or proper or right to take the children's bread and to cast it unto the dogs. She answered and said unto him, yes, Lord. In Matthew, it was truth. Is that right? Truth. Here in Mark, it's yes, Lord. So she's agreeing with him. yet the dogs under the tables eat of the children's crumbs. I'm not here for a whole loaf of bread. I'm not here for even a slice of bread. I may not be able to sit at the table as a child of the covenant and have the blessings of the covenant. I may be a dog. I may be an outcast. I may not even be in the covenant. I'm not in the family. But I tell you what, even the dogs can be under the table and get the crumbs. I may not be able to get a loaf of bread or a slice of bread. And if that's true of the dogs, what's true for the family? If God says you can have the crumbs because you're under the table, what about the family that's seated at the table? Shouldn't we be able to get some bread? Amen. Healing is the children's bread. Pass the bread. I don't have to beg and plead and wonder why. I can just say, I'm here to receive. Blessed be God forever. Pass the bread and thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Oh, but I'm here. She said, I'm here. I may be a dog, but I can get crumbs. And the crumbs, that's going to be good enough for me. The crumbs will bring healing to my daughter. And Jesus said, for this saying, verse 29, he said unto her, for this saying, I have that underlined in my Bible, for this saying. I don't know when I underlined it, many years ago. For this saying. For this saying, 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 go thy way, the devil is gone out of thy daughter. You got what you came for, not because God just decided in his sovereignty and his omnipotence and his omnipresent power and glory, and he just decided to do it in his infinite wisdom. No, you didn't get what you came for because I decided to do it. You didn't get what you came for because I gave in to your pleading. No, you got what you came for because of what you said. Because of what you said. I gave you the opportunity to get mad, and you didn't get mad. I gave you the opportunity to quit, and you didn't quit. I gave you the opportunity to get discouraged and go back home. And you didn't get discouraged and you didn't get go back home. And so for this saying, because of what you did, because of what you said, you got the blessing. You got the blessing. Glory to God. For this saying. Everybody say, for this saying. Well, if you come back to Matthew 9, that's what's happening here. He didn't turn around. He didn't talk to them. He just kept right on going. And it says when he got to the house, verse 28, when he got to the house, Matthew 9, 28, when he was coming to the house. Now, into means he went inside. Isn't that right? When he came into the house. Can you hear the screen door slam shut? I know they didn't have screen doors. Give me some poetic license here. But he goes inside the house. What's he thinking? What's he doing? He's wanting them to stay with it. And I can't heal them unless they do. You mean he can't? In John 5:19, he said he couldn't. You mean Jesus couldn't heal these? He said he couldn't. Well, I just believe Jesus could do whatever he wanted to do. He said he couldn't. He said he couldn't. The Son can do nothing of himself. But I want them healed. Then it'll be their faith. When it's a gift of the Spirit, I can do it. But I have to see the Father do it. I have to see the Father do it. I have to see the Father do it. But if I don't see the Father do it, it'll have to be their faith. And if they have faith, they won't quit. And I'll give them the opportunity to quit. Because faith has to be proven. Without the trying of your faith, it's not proven that it is faith. The trial of your faith is more precious than gold, though it's tried with fire. Faith has to be proven. And then it's found under the praise and glory and honor at his appearing. Faith has to be proven. And if you have faith, if you believe and doubt not, Jesus said, if you have faith, believe and doubt not, you can speak to that mountain and move it. If you have faith and doubt not, did he say that? He didn't say you could pray about it and just know God could move. Well, I believe God's going to move my mountain. He didn't say a thing in the world about God moving it. I know God's the force behind it, but he said, if you speak to the mountain. Did he say that or not? If you speak to the mountain. So there are things that are up to us when very often Christians are putting everything off on God. And God's provided things for us. He's given us his word. He's given us his will. He's given us his provision. He's given us his promise. He's demonstrated his power. And he said, now you seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and the things will be added. And so, if these two blind men will just keep at it, I'm going to give them the opportunity to see if they do. I'm going to walk right on into the house. Just go right on the inside of the house. Just pull up a chair and have a seat and let's watch and see if they come on in. And they did. Thank God they did. So they came in and Jesus said to them, after they came in the house, Jesus said to them, do you believe that I'm able to do this? He's still asking them what they believe. Do you believe that I'm able to do this? And really, he might as well say this, because if you don't, if you don't believe that Jesus is able to do this, then seems like he'd be hindered. Well, I just believe Jesus can do what he wants to do. He said he couldn't. That's why he's asking them if they believed, because there's something about faith that makes a demand on the power. The power's there. The power's there. The power is there. But it's our faith that makes a demand or draw. It puts a draw on the power. It puts a draw. Do you believe that I'm able to do this? If I'd been there, I'd want to say, well, huh? I mean, we kept going, didn't we? We're still here, aren't we? We're inside the house. After how many miles did we walk, Henry? I don't know, but my feet are sore. Do we believe? Are you kidding? Do we believe? If we didn't believe, we would have quit 2 miles ago. Was it 2 miles? I don't know. Do you believe? I'd want to say, huh? Duh. But he's still asking, because faith is released either by action or word or both. The Bible says with your mouth, confession is made, and with your heart, man believeth. Did you notice both are involved? What you believe and then what you say. He wants to know what they believe, and he wants to hear what they say. Did you notice that in Romans chapter 10? For with the heart, man believeth, but the mouth makes confession. The word is nigh thee, even in thy mouth and in thy heart. That is the word of faith which we preach. What is the nature of faith? In the mouth and in the heart. In the mouth and in the heart. The heart believes unto righteousness, but it's the mouth that confession is made. He wants to know what they believe, and he wants to hear them say it. Do you believe that I'm able to do this? Now let me hear you say it. They said, yea, Lord. Then he touched them, and they received their sight. Can somebody say amen? In Mark chapter 6, he could there do no mighty work, save that he laid his hands upon a few sick folk and healed them. And the few he healed couldn't have had much wrong, because he couldn't do a mighty work. So the few sick folk that he healed didn't have much wrong with them. And he's ministering to these few sick folk with minor ailments because of his faith. His faith's not mentioned here, but I've learned by experience, you can help people if they're new to the message in minor ailments with your faith. You can carry baby Christians, even sinners. I've helped sinners receive healing. It's like the dinner bell. Now, Jesus did this. Now, he wants you to serve him. And you can do some small things just on your faith, even in the presence of unbelief. But then also the few sick folk could have had a little faith, and they got a little bit. But he couldn't do a mighty work, and it says he couldn't. Everybody say he couldn't. Now, you hear people say, I just believe Jesus could do anything he wanted to do. He said he couldn't. And the reason he couldn't is revealed in verse 6. He marveled because of their unbelief. Their unbelief hindered him. If their unbelief would hinder Jesus, then unbelief will hinder us. And I believe I've been to that church. Because sometimes you're right in the atmosphere of unbelief. And you're hindered, even if you have the power of God that operated just last week in another place. It won't operate here because of their unbelief. You can fast more. You can pray more. You can be in the Word more. And you had signs, wonders, and mighty deeds just last week in another church. But it won't operate here because of their unbelief. If unbelief hindered Jesus, it'll hinder you. It'll hinder me. It'll hinder us. But he could do some small things, but he couldn't do what he wanted to do because of their unbelief. And the antidote, the response was he went about the villages teaching. What do you do about unbelief? Well, you've got to somehow get teaching into them if they'll hear it. Now, some people today, they're just so religiously brainwashed, they don't even want to hear anything. They're just so full of something that they so think they're right. And they're so indoctrinated with unbelief. I don't know. It's hard in some places. It's just like Jesus' day, Pharisees and Sadducees. And they're arguing about it. Man's traditions of men make the word of God of none effect. But somehow, if you're going to override unbelief, you've got to get faith into people. You've got to get teaching into people. That it may not be exactly the way you've been taught all your life. Can somebody say amen? Well, Jesus wanted to do something, but he couldn't. This is what I want people to get a hold of. Jesus was waiting for them to believe something. The power of God operates as the Spirit wills. The power of God operates as the faith draws it out. It's either the gifts of the Spirit or our faith drawing the power out. God operates in both ways. And then also, you can always be healed by his word. He sent his word and healed. You can always receive healing by the word of God. But the gifts of the Spirit operate from time to time as the Spirit wills. But I tell you, anytime the anointing's present, we can draw it out with faith. Amen. Anytime. And the antidote to unbelief is the teaching on faith. Mark chapter 5 and now verse 25. A certain woman had an issue of blood 12 years. She had suffered. Anyone know anything about that? Suffered many things of many physicians. You know anything about that? She had spent all that she had. I hope no one here knows anything about that. But most of the time, doctors don't do what they do free, do they? And even if they don't get results, they still charge you. So she spent all that she had and was not anything bettered, but rather grew worse. But she heard. Thank God she heard something. I believe what she heard initiated her faith and activated her faith and inspired her and motivated her. And she got to going. She got to going based on what she heard. I know she couldn't have heard what I hear some people say because it wouldn't have motivated anything. She didn't hear, well, God wants you sick to teach you something. That wouldn't have gotten her headed to Jesus. Well, you know, it may be God's will for you to be sick. Maybe he wants you to be sick so he can, work his will out in your life and make you more pious. I never saw sickness make anybody more pious. It seems to me sickness brings the worst out of people. It doesn't bring the best out of them. It brings the worst out of them. It's sometimes a struggle and strain, not only on the individual, but the whole family. The whole family's under pressure now. Well, God wants to remove that pressure. And in Jesus Christ, he has. And the provision has been made. So she didn't hear what some people are hearing today. Well, God wants you sick to teach you something. He put that on you. He's working his will in his time. Well, she didn't hear that. She didn't hear any of that because it wouldn't have got her up and moving. If she had heard, well, in God's time, he's going to heal you. She'd sit at home then wait on God's time. But did you notice she initiated it? In fact, if she had waited a week, her healing would have waited a week. If she had waited a month to get to Jesus, her healing would have waited a month. Well, I just believe when it's the Lord's time. Well, that woman didn't hear that, and she didn't believe that. I'm glad she didn't go to some churches where I visited. Because if she had heard what I heard when I was there, it wouldn't have brought her any faith for healing. But she heard something. She heard of Jesus, and what she heard got her up and moving. And when she acted on what she heard and when she acted on what she believed, she received. And she received based on what she heard, what she believed, and what she did. And I'll say this again. If she had waited a month, her healing would have waited a month. And yet I hear Christians just virtually everywhere I go, when the Lord gets ready. I just believe in His time. I hear that. I don't know if you do or not. I hear it. When the Lord gets ready. I just believe it's all in His timing. I've turned it all over to the Lord and in His timing. Well, she didn't believe that. I'm glad she didn't go to that church. Because if she had waited a year, her healing would have waited a year. If she had waited 6 months, her healing would have waited 6 months. She got up and headed toward Jesus. And when she got to Jesus, that's when she got her healing. She initiated it. And she said, if I just touch the hem of His garment, I'll be well. I'll be whole. And the Greek, the New Testament was written in Greek. The Greek says she said that and kept saying it. She said it and kept saying it. I don't know how long it took for her to get to Jesus, but the inference is every bit of the way she was saying to herself, when I get there, I'm going to receive my healing. When I get there, I'm going to receive my healing. When I get there, I'm going to receive my healing. When I touch the hem of His garment, I'm going to be well. When I get there and He ministers to me, I touch Him. We could do the same thing today. When I get to that meeting and that minister prays for me, when I get to that meeting and hear the preaching, when I get there, I'm going to receive my healing. She said it and kept saying it. And when she got there, she touched the hem of His garment. And Jesus said, who touched me? Didn't he do it? Now, here's something very interesting. He knew virtue had gone out of him. And so he turned him about in the press and said, who touched me? She felt in her body that she was made whole of that plague. She felt it and he felt it. She felt it and he felt it. The tangible anointing of God can be perceived by touch. He said, who touched me? He knew virtue, that word Greek in the Greek is the same for power or the anointing. Acts 10:38 says, God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and power. That's healing power. The Holy Ghost, the gifts of the Spirit, he went about doing good and healing. So he had the gifts of the Spirit, the anointing to preach and teach, and the anointing to minister with the gifts of the Spirit, but he also had healing power because he went about doing good and healing. See, it's the Holy Ghost and power. The Holy Ghost and power. Acts 10:38, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and power. That's healing power because he went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil, for God was with him. And so the Holy Ghost anointing, the Spirit of the Lord's upon me because he's anointed me to preach. He's anointed me to minister. He could preach. He could teach. The power of the Holy Ghost, he had the gifts of the Spirit, all the gifts of the Spirit. John 3:34 says the Spirit or the anointing was not given by measure to him. He had all the anointing. But there's something else other than the anointing of the Holy Ghost to minister as the Spirit wills. There's that resident power that's in him that someone can draw out with their faith. And that's what has not been preached by and large in churches across the land. When someone has that anointing, if they'll wait on their ministry, Romans chapter 12 says, he that ministereth, let him wait on his ministry. If you'll stay ready, stay prepared, stay ready and minister, he that ministereth, let him wait or stay prepared in his ministry, then God has set some in the church, and some have gifts of healings or healing endowments, and that power is resident in them for anyone to draw out with their faith. The gifts of the Spirit operate as the Spirit wills, but when that anointing is present, your faith can draw it out. And Jesus had that anointing, and he asked, who touched me? Well, what happened? The disciples thought he was something's wrong with you. And the disciples said, Jesus, behold, thou seest the multitude thronging thee. And sayest thou, who touched me? I mean, a lot of people are touching you. A lot of people are touching you, Jesus. And yet you're asking this question. They thought it was a foolish question, didn't they? Master, thou seest the multitude thronging thee. We don't throng today. But you know what that means, don't you? They're being pushed up against him and shoved up against him. There's a crowd of people. Some may have been touching him out of curiosity. Maybe somebody said, why don't you touch him? I've heard he heals the sick. Just go ahead and touch him. And, well, let's see if anything happens. I'm going to touch him. Nothing happened. I know they still do that way. They come to me to see if anything's going to happen. Well, I can tell you before, you know, it's not. The gifts of the Spirit could operate, but they don't. That's not God's number one way. That's not his main way. The gifts of the Spirit are not God's main way. John chapter 5 is not God's main way. The two blind men, do you believe that I'm able to do this? That's God's main way. Jesus would preach the gospel, and when they believed, some places where he preached, he healed them all, but he preached and they believed. There's places where they sought to touch him because virtue went out of him and he healed them all. Well, they came to hear him and to be healed. Twice in the gospels it says they came to hear him and to be healed. People today come to be healed. Very often they don't come to hear. Is that right or not? They came to hear. The main way that God heals the sick, even in Jesus' ministry, was by the faith of the individual. That's the main way. I said that's the main way. Even in Jesus' ministry, the main way Jesus healed the sick was the faith of the individual and the healing anointing. The healing anointing and the faith of the individual. The gifts of the Spirit were not the main way. Not in Jesus' ministry, not in our day. Every once in a while we see people healed that way. And y'all come, we'll pray. You never know. It might be your night. And that's what churches across the land do. Y'all come, we'll pray. Jesus is our healer. By whose stripes you were healed. Y'all come, you never know. This might be your night. Come on. Y'all come, we'll pray. Well, let's all believe God. And every once in a while, somebody gets healed. And that encourages us to keep coming. But at the Pool of Bethesda, only one would get healed. And there's a multitude of impotent folk, blind, halt, withered, waiting for the moving of the water. A multitude of people there. Can somebody say, man, Jesus wants to heal them all. But he only healed one. The gifts of the Spirit operate that way. It's not God's main way. God's main way is faith in his word and the healing anointing. His best way is just you and the word of God. But drawing the anointing out of a minister, when it's receiving through a ministry, his main way is the healing anointing in your faith. God's main way to bring healing is by your faith, not just his sovereignty. Every once in a while he heals by his sovereignty, but that's not his main way. People need to know that. So this woman touched him, was healed, and Jesus expressly and explicitly referred to her. The multitude thronged thee. Well, I know a lot of people are touching me, but not a one of them are being healed. Do you remember in Luke chapter 5 when they tore the roof open and let down that man? Jesus saw their faith and said, son, your sins are forgiven. They got mad at him. Who is this that can forgive sins? Nobody but God alone can do that. And he said, so that you'll know that the Son of Man has power on earth to forgive sins, he said to the man sick of the palsy, take up your bed and walk, go into your house, get out of this unbelief. You'll lose your healing if you stay around here. It's what he could have said. But did you notice there in Luke chapter 5, it says he preached the word and the power was present to heal them? Have you ever noticed that? He preached the word and the power was present to heal them. To heal them. Everybody say them. Is that plural? That's more than one, isn't it? But only one got healed. And the man that got healed wasn't one of them that he was preaching to. He came through the roof. They tore up a hole and got the bed, you know, down through that hole in the roof. Let him down. four friends, took him to church and couldn't find a way to get there, so tore a hole in the roof. And Jesus saw their faith. But he preached the word, and the power of the Lord was present to heal them. But not a one of them got healed. Not a one of them. And yet the power was there. See, we got to get hold. Well, I guess it wasn't God's will. It is God's will. It was God's will. But the power, even though present, is released by faith. Not a one of them got healed. Yet the power was there. The power was there. But not a one of them. Only him. The one that was let down through the roof. Only him. But not them. And there in Luke 5, it says the power of the Lord was present to heal them. In Hebrews chapter 4, verse 2, it says the word preached didn't profit, not being mixed with faith. You can preach it, but if people don't mix faith with it, it doesn't profit. Well, I just believe when God gets ready. No, he's already ready. He's been ready. He put Jesus on the cross 2,000 years ago. He was ready then. He's still ready. He's not going to do one more thing about it. I just believe when he gets ready, well, he's not. You mean he's not going to heal me? Well, he's not going to do one more thing about it. Not going to do another thing. Not one more thing. Amen. And so this woman drew it out of Jesus. And yet others were touching and the power was there. The power was present to heal them, but not a one of them got healed, only her. The word preached didn't profit when not being mixed with faith. She drew it out because of her faith. He even said, your faith did this. He didn't say my power, though his power is involved. He didn't say my faith, though I'm sure he had faith, but he didn't refer to it. He didn't say the apostles and I, you know, we all got together this morning and prayed and we were believing God that this was going to happen. He didn't say any of that. He said, your faith did it. Well, if her faith healed her, your faith can heal you. But what did her faith do? Her faith drew the anointing out that was resident in him by God. And God today has set some in the church today who has endowments, anointings. It operates the same way. It operates the same way. And the woman with her faith drew it out. Jesus looked round about to see her that had done this thing. And she, fearing and trembling, fell down before him and told him all the truth. Daughter, be of good cheer. Your faith hath made you whole. Go in peace and be whole of thy plague. Your faith did it. Your faith did it. And it seems inferred that other than he had the power of God, he wasn't involved. He didn't make a decision on who to heal and who didn't heal. I had a preacher say one time, God could have chosen any way he wanted to heal her. Or that Jesus could have chosen any way to heal her, but he chose to heal her that way. Well, the inference was he didn't even know she was there. He looked around about to see her that had done this thing. He asked her the question, who touched me? And nobody said anything, so he's looking round about to see her. Who touched me? Then she, fearing and trembling, she realizes she can't be hid, came and fell down before him and told him all the truth. Your faith did it. The anointing's here. Your faith drew it out. I felt it leave me. He knew in himself virtue had gone out of him. Virtue just went out of me. Who touched me? Virtue just went out of me. Who touched me? It operates that way today. And God wants us well. He's put a number of ways in the Bible that we can receive healing. He so much wants us well, he's put a number of ways for us to receive healing. You can receive healing just on your own. What things soever you desire, when you pray, believe that you receive them, you'll have them. And then just stand your ground. Blessed be God, I have it. Or you can say, I'm going to draw the anointing out of that one. I believe he's anointed. He has a healing ministry, healing anointing. I've prayed for any number of people and nothing happened because they're waiting for me to push it into them. They're waiting on God to do it. But I tell you, when they hear the teaching, and sometimes it takes a while. With Tammy, it took about a year for her to undo the 30 years of wrong teaching that she had heard. It takes a while to undo wrong teaching. And she had been going from church to church and meeting to meeting and minister to minister to get healed. Is that right? Waiting on God to do it. And it's different for different people. But with her, she was growing and growing and growing and growing. Then there came to the place, well, I'm going to draw it out of him. He's going to minister to me. He's going to lay hands on me, and I'm going to take it. And I tell you, I prayed for her before and tried to push it into her, and nothing happened. But then it's like you get a hold of a live wire. You ever touch an electric wire? A live wire? I touched her and power flowed. Power flowed. She ended up in the floor. Not everybody falls, but some people shake. Some people, you know, different things. And then the power can be dissipated or it's not maintained. You've got to leave this place believing, well, it's in me, and maintain it and keep it, because sometimes contrary winds will come. The storms of life come to us all, and you have to stand your ground and not be moved by what you see or what you feel. Well, that power was administered to me. I received it. It's in me working. That power is in me working. Healing power is in me working. I received my healing. Thank God it's in me working. And then she went back to the doctor, and the doctor's report was worse. I encouraged her, don't be moved by that. The healing power is in you working. God's watching what you do and what you say and what you believe now. I said essentially those words, didn't I? And then she goes back again to the doctor. And from that day, I mean, it's the right direction. Instead of, what was it? Kidney failure. What was it? Level what? Level 3 kidney failure. But not anymore. Amen. She, in all likelihood, she wouldn't be here tonight if she had gone the way that the natural was headed. And yet, when the power went into her, it didn't cause an instant manifestation, instant healing. But it works. Amen. That power is in me working. Can you say amen? Amen. God wants you well. God wants you well. Turn and tell your neighbor, God wants you well. Can you raise your hands and just thank God for it? Healing is the children's bread. Say it again out loud. Healing is the children's bread. Thank you, Father, for the bread. Bread of life, bread of healing. Thank you, Father, for healing in the family of God. In the name of Jesus, we thank you, Father. We thank you, Father. We thank you, Father. Hallelujah. And we expect it. We thank you, Father, for it. Father, I lay my hands upon Karen in the name of Jesus. I command every sickness and every disease that's flowing right into you, dear. Praise God. Glory, 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 glory. Raise your hands and praise Him. Father, thank you for your healing in Karen. Thank you, Father, for your healing. We give you glory, Jesus. We give you glory. We give you glory.